In the name of our loving God, Creator, Word, and Holy Spirit. Amen. God is with you. Good morning and welcome. It's good to have you here. We are marking the slightly transferred Festival of the Presentation. It's normally the 2nd of February, but we've moved it, as is common in Anglican tradition, to the Sunday nearest. And we're observing something that we haven't done before. We're going to be observing a little ritual of the blessing of the candles. This time is also known as Candlemas. And so in just a moment, we will be blessing candles. And as those who are present here leave, I encourage you to pick up a candle. And if you're watching online in the coming weeks, to light that candle, as we say, the church family prayer. Before we begin, we do acknowledge that we are on the lands of the Lekwungen people, now known by their colonial names as the Songhees and Esquimalt Nations, and we make that acknowledgement as part of our ongoing journey, a journey taken in partnership with the indigenous peoples of this place, a journey that we hope will be a place of truth-telling, painful as that may be, leading to healing and reconciliation. And we open our hearts and our lives to one another and to all the peoples of this land. So for those of you watching online and those of you who are present here, a warm welcome. I'm going to ask those who have our candles for blessing to come this way. Let us pray. May the light and peace of Jesus the Christ be with you. Let us give thanks to our loving God. Blessed are you, Lord our God, King of the universe. You make darkness to be light, and with you is the well of life. And in your light we see light. Blessed be God forever. Loving God, springing source of everlasting light, pour into the hearts of your faithful people the brilliance of your eternal splendor, that we, who by these candles will light the world, may together stand before you in that eternal city where you live and reign, Creator, Word, and Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. We wait for your loving kindness, O God, in the midst of your temple. Open to us the gates of righteousness, that we may enter and give thanks to our God. God is the one who has shown us light. Let us offer in God's dwelling an oblation with great gladness. Let us pray.
Of our family, as we gather in our church buildings, our homes, and online.
Through your spirit, keep us united in love. Bless each of us with your beloved friendship. Teach us, gracious God,
how to be your church in these times. Help us to know that we are your people. We are your family always. Amen.
Thank you.
We open our hearts and minds to our loving God. Almighty God, to you all hearts are open, all desires known, and from you no secrets are hidden. Cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name, through Christ our Lord. Amen. Let us hold this moment open to the loving Spirit of God. God of Anna and Simeon, whose law makes known the gift of love and life, whose love exposes our hardness of heart, by your Spirit, may we receive your faithful word and know your reconciling presence offered for all the world. Through Jesus Christ, the light and the glory of God. Amen. Please be seated and let us listen for the word of God in Holy Scripture.
A reading from the prophet Malachi. See, I am sending my messenger to prepare the way before me, and the Lord whom you seek will suddenly come to his temple. The messenger of the covenant in whom you delight. Indeed, he is coming, says the Lord of hosts. But who can endure the day of his coming, and who can stand when he appears? For he is like a refiner's fire, and like fuller's soap. He will sit as a refiner and purifier of silver, and he will purify the descendants of Levi, and refine them like gold and silver, until they present offerings to the Lord in righteousness. Then the offering of Judah and Jerusalem will be pleasing to the Lord, as in the days of old, and as in the former years. Hear what the Spirit is saying. A reading from a letter to the Hebrews. Since, therefore, the children share flesh and blood, he himself likewise shared the same things, so that through death he might destroy the one who has the power of death, that is, the devil, and free those who all their lives were held in slavery by the fear of death. For it is clear that he did not come to help angels, but the descendants of Abraham. Therefore, he had to become like his brothers and sisters in every respect, so that he might be a merciful and faithful high priest in the service of God, to make a sacrifice of atonement for the sins of the people. Because he himself was tested by what he suffered, he is able to help those who are being tested. Hear what the Spirit is saying.
God is with you. Hear the good news of Jesus Christ according to Luke. When the time came for their purification according to the law of Moses, they brought him up to Jerusalem to present him to the Lord. As it is written in the law of the Lord, every firstborn male shall be designated as holy to the Lord. And they offered a sacrifice according to what is stated in the law of the Lord, a pair of turtle doves or two young pigeons. Now there was a man in Jerusalem whose name was Simeon. This man was righteous and devout, looking forward to the consolation of Israel, and the Holy Spirit rested upon him. It had been revealed to him by the Holy Spirit that he would not see death before he had seen the Lord's Messiah. Guided by the Spirit, Simeon came into the temple, and when the parents brought in the child Jesus to do for him what was customary under the law, Simeon took him in his arms and praised God, saying, "Master, now you are dismissing your servant in peace according to your word. For my eyes have seen your salvation, which you have prepared in the presence of all peoples, a light for revelation to the Gentiles and for the glory to your people Israel." And the child's father and mother were amazed at what was being said about him. Then Simeon blessed them and said to his mother Mary, "This child is destined for the falling and the rising of many in Israel, and to be a sign that will be opposed, so that the inner thoughts of many will be revealed. And a sword will pierce your own soul too." There was also a prophet Anna, the daughter of Phanuel, of the tribe of Asher. She was of a great age, having lived with her husband for 7 years after her marriage, and then as a widow to the age of 84. She never left the temple, but worshiped there with fasting and prayer night and day. At that moment, she came and began to praise God and to speak about the child to all who were looking for the redemption of Jerusalem. When they had finished everything required by the law of the Lord, they returned to Galilee, to their own town of Nazareth. The child grew and became strong, filled with wisdom, and the favor of God was upon him. The Gospel of Christ.
Thank you.
Before I turn the mic, oh, the mic is on. Please be seated. So remember a few years back, well, some of you will remember a few years back, way back in the midst of time, you know, pre-pandemic, when there was time, 2014, this Sunday. Does anyone remember what happened during the sermon? Oh, good, can I just do it again? No. As I started preaching, a whole lot of people in the congregation started shouting, God is here. You remember that one? Those of you who were here 8 years ago, it was one of those harebrained moments I had, sort of waking up in the morning. I phoned a whole load of people and said, as I start speaking, can you shout, God is here? And they did. And it was a nice, it got some attention. It was in the sense that people were actually wondering what, for goodness sake, the sermon was going to be about if people started shouting at the beginning. So 8 years ago this Sunday, we were being reminded that God is here. I'm not going to preach the same sermon, but I thought it was worth reminding us of that both small and infinite understanding that is at the heart of our faith. God is here. One of the names given to Jesus, Emmanuel, God is with us. Not God above us, not God apart from us, not God will be with us or God has been with us, although both those statements are true, but God is with us. And that bold proclamation is the foundation of today's gospel reading. Anna and Simeon encounter the baby Jesus and proclaim, God is here, both in word and in action. Simeon, through the words that we've come to know as the Nunc Dimittis, Lord, now they let us thou thy servant depart in peace. I've said it so often at Evensong that it's kind of lodged in oldie Englishy in my head. And Anna, with words of praise and speaking all that the child would accomplish. This is the presentation of Jesus in the temple. These proclamations, which are, Luke is very keen to point out in his gospel, fully the work of the Holy Spirit, a theme that will crop up again and again in Luke's gospel, they burst in on the activity of Mary and Joseph as they seek to fulfill the holy law and offer the sacrifice due. God is here, they hear. God is in this child. God is in this place, in this activity, in the promise of who Jesus is, in the embracing of those outside the expectations of the day, notably the Gentiles, in this act of taking, blessing, and sharing. As an aside, these are the formal actions also of our Eucharist, that the bread and wine is taken, blessed, and shared. And my understanding of this sacrament, and one that I know that is common in the Anglican Communion, is that it is in the sharing of communion that the sacrament is made, and this is one of my favorite words, efficacious, in which the moment of grace is present, consubstantiation. It's not what I do when I'm there, waving my hands over bread and wine, but in the words that we say, it's in that sharing of the bread that we will do later. But that was a little digression. As we discussed in Sermon Circle on Wednesday, there's one thing that really stands out, one word that really stood out for me and for many of us in the readings for today. Salvation. And salvation is a slippery word for us to use. It has become so mixed up with images of being saved from sin, or saved from being a sinner, or saved from hell, or whatever saved from you want to make. That's not the concept of salvation we get from the Greek word, which is there in the middle of it. Soterios, usually translated, yes, as salvation, but it's a word that is actually related to restoration, to bringing soundness back to something that was broken, to healing, to preservation, and to protection. Its roots for us go back into our Hebrew forebears, who understood salvation as the restoration of wholeness, often referred to as shalom, peace, unity, community, wholeness, healing, all those things mixed up in that one word. For those of us raised in the past couple hundred years, and I think I can include all of us in that, don't think I'm inaccurate saying that, we have all been formed by the church and by a popular understanding that salvation is to be understood in terms of Jesus taking a bullet for us. Taking the bullet for us all being wicked. I am bad. Jesus needs to save me, is what we have been told. Because somehow God can't do any forgiving unless someone gets hurt. Within the reading from the letter to the Hebrews today, that is the way most of us will see the writer's reference to a sacrifice of atonement. But that's in part because our lens for looking at this is so fogged up by one way of looking at the life, death, and resurrection of Jesus that has become predominant in the church and in popular culture since the Reformation, the idea of substitutionary atonement or penal substitution, that Jesus had to die to pay the penalty for sin because God was angry at sin and we are, and I quote, sinners in the hands of an angry God. That's an oversimplification of the idea of penal substitution, but it's not an unfair one. Sin causes God anger. God cannot live with sin. Sin must be paid for, and Jesus paid the price. No. Just no. It's a theology that seems to suggest that God cannot forgive without someone getting it in the neck. That mercy can only happen if a certain set of circumstances are fulfilled. That somehow suffering is needed for God to love us. It's a theology that can't cope with the idea that things sometimes happen because they happen. One of the hardest things that we often struggle with is that God might not control everything. Perhaps stuff happens because it happens. On a philosophical level, if we truly believe that God gives us freedom, then the concept of God guiding every act and consequence contradicts that. It's a view that absolves us from responsibility, an immature view that prevents us from being truly adult and taking credit and blame for our own lives. I think it was C.S. Lewis that once wrote, "God and the devil get an awful lot of blame for things they have nothing to do with." And it's hard to let go of the idea of God being all-powerful, infinite, all-knowing, and all-loving. An understanding of God rooted deep in many spiritual traditions and philosophies. It's hard to let go of the idea of control, that everything happens, quote, for a reason. As if God uses suffering and pain to teach us, like an angry parent standing over us and saying, "I'm going to teach you a lesson." Well, I believe that's a deeply inadequate view of God. Hard as it may be, sometimes all we can do is look at suffering and say, there is no meaning to this. There is no reason. God is not trying to teach us something through it. God is not getting us to fit into a plan. God is not causing suffering. God does not say that so-and-so gets ill or so-and-so gets rich because of their wickedness or their virtue, or in order that they may grow spiritually through this experience. But, and this is the witness that I find in Scripture, God is with us in all things, in joy and in suffering, alongside us, suffering with us, heartbroken, soul-pierced. The God who chooses to act within us and through us is the same God who is with us in good and bad. This God was alongside Christ in all that Jesus went through, but did not make it happen in order to satisfy some kind of heavenly bank account. When we hear that Christ is a sacrifice, there is more about that self-offering of Jesus than there is to the need for a sacrifice to pay a price. There is that feeling of self-giving that comes from what Jesus did, his absolute commitment to the values of God and the life which we call the reign of God. Jesus dying, I would say, is the result of his dedication to the outcasts and to the unloved, to standing up to oppression and the forces of empire, to the truth of God in all things, and the calling to justice and the removal of those things which draw people away from God. He speaks out against injustice and intolerance and the misuse of power for personal, religious, or political ends. That's why he was executed, not to satisfy an angry God who needed appeasing. That is salvation. That is why a sword would pierce Mary's heart, because this commitment to truth and love would bring Jesus to death and suffering. As Christians, we are not exempt to suffering. We don't, as this community knows, get an easy ride because we are people of faith. In fact, if we are committed to the values of Christ, then we too find ourselves in danger of suffering, even to the point of vilification and pain. Even within the discipline of opening ourselves up to God, we will find things that cause us pain, facing up to those things which turn us inwards to the exclusion of others, or the exclusion of God, or the exclusion of that which is best for us. I believe that the judgment that Malachi talks of in our reading from the Hebrew Scriptures today is not the kind of judgment where God looks at humankind and says, "You are bad and you need punishing," but a judgment which says, "You are graced. Come to me that I may give you life." In our Western adversarial view of justice, we see the judge as adjudicating between right and wrong. But in a view that seems more consistent with Scripture, we're told the Holy Spirit is an advocate who walks alongside us, speaking for us, encouraging us, enlivening, bringing hope and affirmation. In an adversarial justice system, someone must be punished. In advocate systems, reconciliation, restoration, and healing is the mark of true justice. So we come back to the opening of my thoughts. And I'm actually going to use a version of the theme that I used 8 years ago. So sometimes I do recycle bits of old sermons. I believe that these readings, with their talk of salvation and suffering and pain, of atonement and judgment, hold a very positive message behind them. And that is, God is here. God is here alongside those of us who are broken and suffering. God is here even in the midst of pandemic. God is here alongside the one called to stand up for what is good and for right, no matter what the cost. God is here with those whose path of faith is a struggle and with those whose path of faith is a joy. God is here even when suffering is meaningless, when there is no reason for bad things happening. God is here as we share and support one another and love and care and speak and struggle and pray and hope and cling to faith. God is here. Amen. As you are able, I invite you to stand as we affirm the faith of the Church. We believe and trust in God the Creator. We believe and trust in Jesus Christ, incarnate Word. We believe and trust in the Holy Spirit. We believe and trust in the three in one. And now standing, seated, or kneeling, as is your custom, let us pray.
Made like us in every respect, our high priest knows our suffering and accompanies us before the throne of mercy. Brothers and sisters, let us pray through Christ, saying, Lord, have mercy. Here on these lands, we pray for our Lekwungen brothers and sisters and give thanks for them and for the land. For the Songhees and Esquimalt nations, let us pray to the Lord. In the Canadian Church, we pray for Linda, our primate, and Lynn, our metropolitan. We pray for the Diocese of Caledonia and Bishop David Lehman. Within our diocese, we pray for Bishop Anna, and for the Congregation of St. Paul Nanaimo and their priest, Clara Plamondon. For our church, that it be a light for all nations and a beacon for all peoples, let us pray to the Lord. This week, we commemorated the Shoah, the mass murder of 6 million Jews for being Jewish or of Jewish extraction, as well as the mass murder of millions of others, Roma, Sinti, homosexuals, political dissidents. We give our thanks to God for the life and witness of Judaism, surviving and flourishing after these and countless catastrophes. We acknowledge before God the lessons and the warning of this and other catastrophes and what they provide us for working in the present to prevent, abate, and oppose fanatical hatred and violence. We reflect before God on the complicity of the Church and of members of the Church in these moral catastrophes. And we remember also before God those within and beyond the Church who resisted and saved lives. We reflect with gratitude on our common roots in the Torah and Tanakh, and the interfaith dialogues that have helped us cast aside the shackles of anti-Semitism and racism. We pray for the true peace and justice of the Holy Land, and we reflect on our duty as Christians and as human beings before the promise, never again. And so for God's people, Israel, first to hear the word of God, let us pray to the Lord. Let us pray for essential workers in hospitals, in first responder services, and in the supply chains that sustain us. Let us pray for their strength in the face of exhaustion and opposition. Let us pray for policymakers and policy implementers. And more generally, then, for the minds and hearts of those who act and work for the public good. Let us pray to the Lord. Let us pray for the gift of contemplative prayer and for the gift of seeing one another deeply with care, each made, however unfathomably, in the image of God and as a child of God. Even as we remember before God and one another that our time here is short and thus of infinite worth, let us pray for these inner and outer workings of pilgrimage by which this mortal flesh takes on immortality and death itself loses its sting. And so we pray for God's reign of peace, that no people need live in the fear of death. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
Let us remember the prophetic voices that are among us now and have come before us, remembering especially Archbishop Desmond Tutu and the many others who came before us. For those who speak and those who hear the prophetic word today, let us pray to the Lord. Let us pray for wisdom in old age and for fidelity in youth. Let us pray for the unhoused and those without sufficient heat or cooling as the seasons turn. Let us pray for those who cannot leave their homes in bad weather and those who have lost their homes this year in fire, in flood, in mudslides, and in avalanches. Let us also remember those who have lost their homes from rent eviction, from coming out to their families and living with integrity, from unaffordable rents or taxes, from mental health and addiction, and from familial abuse or discord. For those who suffer from the winter's cold, let us pray to the Lord. Let us pray for the troubled places of this world, remembering especially this day the people of Ukraine and of Russia, for those living in addiction or without a home, for those with severe or long COVID, and those whose surgeries have been postponed because of the current health conditions. Let us remember all those who walk in darkness, facing illness, death, mental and emotional distress, or other misfortune. Let us pray to the Lord. God of mercy, be our light in times of darkness and our comfort in times of affliction. May we be as light in a darkened world, proclaiming your faithful love, if necessary, with words. The power of truth is the fuel for the flame, so the darker the ages get, there's a stronger beacon yet. We ask this through Christ, our one high priest, who lives and reigns with you and the Spirit, one God, forever and ever. Amen.
Christ came proclaiming peace, peace to those who are near, peace to those far off. May the peace of Christ be with you always. Let us safely offer one another a sign of peace. And can I remind you to keep your masks on as we move around? Thank you. Let us pray. God of life and freedom, we celebrate the revelation of Jesus as the Christ who makes all creation new. Accept all we offer you this day and make us new in him, who is Lord forever and ever. Amen. Thanks be to you, Lord Jesus Christ, for all the benefits you have given us and all that you have borne for us. In our sharing in this Eucharist, in church or at home, we ask you to come spiritually into our hearts. O most merciful Redeemer, friend and brother, may we know you more clearly, love you more dearly, and follow you more nearly, day by day. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. Worship and praise belong to you, God, our Maker. Out of nothing you called all worlds into being, and still you draw the universe to its fulfillment. Day and night celebrate your glory till time shall be no more. In Christ, your only begotten Son, you have revealed yourself to the world. By the guiding of a star you made him known to the nations as the Son of David and King of Israel, that in following him we might be led from darkness into marvelous light. Filled with the Spirit who descended upon your Son at his baptism in the Jordan, we who are baptized strive for God's reign, in whose radiance we are transfigured and the earth is transformed. As children of your loving hand, we offer you our praise with angels and archangels and the whole company of heaven, singing the hymn of your unending glory. Thanksgiving be to you, most loving God. In Jesus the Messiah, you have come to us, our hope, in whom you are well pleased. Having been shown to the world as your beloved Son, he proclaimed the good news of your coming. The blind received their sight, the lame walked, the lepers were cleansed, and the captives were set free. At his word, water became wine, the hungry were filled with bread, and the dead were raised. Before he was given up to suffering and death, and at supper with his disciples, he took bread and offered you thanks. He broke the bread and gave it to them, saying, "Take, eat. This is my body, which is given for you." After supper, he took the cup. He offered you thanks and gave it to them, saying, "Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for all, that sins may be forgiven. Do this in remembrance of me." We recall his blessed passion and death, his glorious resurrection and ascension, and we look for the coming of God's reign. Made one with God, we offer you these gifts, and with them ourselves, a single, holy, living sacrifice. Hear us, most merciful God, and send your Holy Spirit upon us and upon this bread and wine, that we may be kindled with the fire of your love and renewed for the service of your reign. Help us, who are baptized into the fellowship of Christ's body, to live and work to your praise and glory. May we grow together in unity and love, until at last, in your new creation, we enter into our heritage in the company of Mary, the apostles and prophets, and of all peoples living and departed. Through Jesus Christ, with whom and in whom, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all honor and glory be to you, God of all ages, world without end. As our Savior has taught us, we now pray. We break the bread of life, and that life is the light of the world. God, here among us, light in the midst of us, bring us to light and life. And as we keep a respectful distance from one another, I invite you all to come and share, for none are excluded from Christ's table, for it is Christ's table and not the church's. These are the gifts of God for all the people of God. Thanks be to God.
Thank you.
us pray. Gracious God, lover of all, by this sacrament you make us one family in Christ your Son, one in the sharing of his body and blood, one in the communion of his Spirit. Help us to grow in love for one another and come to the full maturity of the body of Christ. We ask this in Christ's name. Amen. One body are we. Although we are in many places, we spiritually share one bread. I'm going to ask you if you wouldn't mind being seated for a moment, please, before I say the prayer of blessing and our sending out. First of all, don't forget to take your candles. And for those of you at home, please, if you are able to, come and grab a candle from the office any day, Monday to Friday, 9:30 till 12:30. If you really can't get to the office, let us know and we'll bring you one of our blessed candles. And we encourage you to light it during the lighting of the church family prayer until we reach Lent. So just 3 or 4 weeks from now. Secondly, there's a sad notice, and I know they're not expecting it and don't want it, but I'm still going to say it. Michael and Paul have given so much to the life of our community over many years, and latterly, Michael, as rector's warden, has been a great support and strength for me personally, and Paul is just there all the time and does so much. He's been on our serving team, sacristan, and he's stands in his crucifer. He does all trades, and he's a master of most of them, actually. So thank you so much, Paul and Michael, for all you have given us. God bless you, and Godspeed to Parksville, and we pray that you settle in. And you won't be strangers to us in our new Zoom-connected age, and that we will still get to see you. But thank you. Thank you. God bless. See, in non-COVID times, there would have been a cake. Anyway, I'll try and post you one. So I won't ask you to stand again until we sing in just a moment, but where we are, let's just bow our heads and pray. May God bless you and keep you. May God show the light of God's countenance to you. May God grant you the light of their countenance and give you peace, and the blessing of our loving God, who is Creator, Word, and Living Spirit, be among you and those whom you love, and remain with you always. Amen. Before the dismissal, I rather feel like I should be singing Give Me Oil in My Lamp at this point, because our candles, obviously, it seems an appropriate thing at the end of Candlemas that the candles are going out. So, let us go in peace to love and serve our living God. Thanks be to God.